Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Hugh Thompson.
Morning. Welcome to day two of RSA Conference. I hope everybody is having a good time here in Amsterdam. So I got a little concerned last night after the Flash Talks presentation. I overheard a fairly sizable group of attendees talking about visiting some of the local coffee shops. So I must say I am impressed and surprised to see many of those faces in the audience today. So I admire your fortitude. I want to talk a little bit about some of the changes that we've seen in information security just over the last year. I think the last year is a really important tipping point for us. And you'll hear a lot at this conference, you already have, about big data and analytics and what it might do for threat intelligence. But I think there's a bigger transition that's happening in this space. A time when we're actually getting to a ground truth of what works in security and what doesn't. And that's what's been missing for a very, very long time. Those of us that have been in this field for what seems like forever has known that the Achilles heel has always been metrics. How do you justify, even a year after you bought that box that sits in the corner in the data center that's supposed to be doing something from a security perspective, how do you justify that it's actually doing something that matters? And I think we're moving into a time in this industry where we can actually get a ground truth and figure out what matters and what doesn't. We're not alone in this transition. I think any mature discipline, any mature industry has gone through it. And that's what I want to talk about. Share some lessons from other industries that have gone through the transition from superstition and precedent to real data-driven decisions and what the implications of that have been. And I'm going to spend some time talking about a concept in statistics called degrees of freedom. But before I get there, I wanted to start off by sharing a personal security story with you. This happened to me about 13 years ago. So I was right in the middle of doing my PhD, and I spent my summers at a very large, unnamed software company located in Washington State, right? So very large, unnamed software company in Washington State. And at the time, you know, if you think about that in context, 2000, that was an incredible year for technology. Really, really bright people there. You know, I probably spent 100 hours a week basically slapped there every single weekend, and it would be coding, testing, and occasional Star Trek marathon. That would be the regimen. But it was an important time in the server space, too. Microsoft had just released Windows Server 2000. It's big adoption. A lot of people were very excited about that. I was working on another enterprise server product, and we were very close to release. And so we're right in the final days of doing the crunch testing. I mean, we're throwing everything at this application, everything in the kitchen sink, every type of test that we could think of. We were trying load, we were trying exploratory testing. And I remember it was a Saturday that my then boss and his 2-year-old son showed up in the lab, and the lab is a complete disaster. It's row after row after row of machines and mice hanging off of stands and keyboards on the floor. It's actually incredibly dangerous now that I think about it from a 2-year-old's perspective. But we're talking about the current release. And he said, how are things going? And I said, things are going great. It's been a few days, no major incidents, no very serious crashes. You know, I'm feeling really, really optimistic, right? Then he looks down and his 2-year-old's gone. So we're trying to figure out, you know, where did his son go to? We're going aisle by aisle looking for him. And we finally find him sitting in front of a keyboard on the floor. And the machine that keyboard is connected to has the blue screen of death. And immediately I realize I'm in trouble, because no matter what's just gone down here, there's going to be comments like, my 2-year-old could have found this, and things like that that I know would haunt me forever. So we tried to figure out, what did this two-year-old do? Like, what this whole team of people that had not gotten it to crash within the last few days, what did the two-year-old do? And so we came up with all these interesting theories. We measured the two-year-old, figured out how tall he was, you know, simulated trying to pull on wires and things that might be connected. That didn't work, although it was very entertaining for about an hour. And then we tried other things, right? We tried to figure out what mattered and what didn't. Like, the two-year-old had a wet diaper at the time, so we took a towel and put some moisture on it and put it on the keyboard. None of that worked. And then a very disturbing scene of a then me 25-year-old and a 45-year-old crawling down the hall in the lab trying to do a dramatic, a reinterpretation of what this kid did. And finally, we thought, well, we'll just enlist the kid again and incentivize him to do it. So we put a cookie, a physical cookie, on the keyboard. We placed the kid at the entrance to that aisle, and then we hid behind the side and just watched his behavior to figure out what he'd do. And of course, he went down, he just ate the cookie, and then he left. So that wasn't very useful either. But those of you who have ever been in the field of testing or have ever done any QA, it is a field very built upon, at least at that time, superstition. You start to think about all these things that could be relevant, and then you find out at the end what really matters and what doesn't. And I'd argue that that is the test of the maturity of any industry, is figuring out what matters and what doesn't. It turned out that this particular bug was a problem with the sticky keys feature. I don't know if anybody remembers sticky keys. It's like the most annoying feature that was ever added to Windows. But if you press the shift button multiple times, I think it's 5 times, this little box comes up and says, dude, you really seem to like the shift button. Would you like for us to permanently hold it down for you? And almost always the answer is no. And it turns out that's exactly what the kid did. He sat on the keyboard, sat on the shift key, sticky keys came up, and we had a named pipe that we were using that interfered with sticky keys, and that was a crash. But it took us a long time to figure out what mattered in that situation and what didn't. And I would say that in security, we know very little today, but we will know very much 5 years from now on what is effective from a security perspective that we've been doing for a long time and what just hasn't been. And there's a term for this in statistics called degrees of freedom. And a degree of freedom is something that doesn't matter. It's something that if it changes, if it varies in the equation, it doesn't matter. Like, it didn't matter that the two-year-old had a wet diaper, although we spent about half an hour figuring that it would. And the maturity of a field is defined based on how quickly you can identify what your degrees of freedom actually are. So this is the technical definition. It's the number of independent ways by which a dynamic system can move without violating any constraints on it. So you care about the fact that the garbage truck that comes and collects your garbage doesn't have a flat tire. That is not a degree of freedom. But you don't care if it's painted orange or green or purple. It's still going to serve its purpose. I would argue that in security, we don't have a good grasp of our degrees of freedom because we don't have good metrics. But other industries have now moved past the transitionary point that we are now in. And I'd like to explore some of the implications of when we can understand our degrees of freedom. Take, for example, the field of baseball. I just found out that the Netherlands is number 5 in the world in baseball, which is very surprising, so congratulations on that. But baseball has gone through an incredible transformation over the last 20 years. 20 years ago, teams made multi-million dollar bets on players just based on a gut feeling by a couple of people. So there would be baseball scouts that showed up in college games and high school. look at somebody and say, I like the way this kid throws, or this guy's got a really great stance. And based on that opinion, they'd say, we want this person and we don't want this other person. And that's how it ran for a long time. There was a pretty popular book and movie based on the transition of moving from that to a statistics-based approach called Moneyball that some of you may have seen. Now, I had this year the opportunity to sit down with the guy who was behind this Moneyball transition, the general manager of the Oakland A's, and he said when he first introduced this concept to his peers, that what we should do, instead of letting these scouts who seem to know everything, instead of letting them make these choices, we should run deep statistical analysis. And it's fascinating because he said the first response from the baseball community was fear. People were incredibly concerned about their own jobs. They were really concerned that if folks knew the truth, it would expose very bad bets that people had made inside the industry, inside teams. And I'd say that the transition that we're going through now in information security to some is very scary. Because what it may tell us as we get better metrics is that this system or this box or this training campaign or this thing that we've been doing for a really long time that's been really expensive from a security perspective is actually a degree of freedom. It actually doesn't matter that much in terms of the growth and security of the business. Now, if you think about how baseball works now, there's an incredible amount of analytics. They look at every pitch, every swing. All of those things factor in to how they choose and make up a team. It's an important transition to think about because the early adopters, the teams that decided to adopt this first, were the ones that outperformed in the league, unbelievably so. Teams with very small budgets that were able to make the playoffs. Teams that had very limited resources who were able to outperform teams that had massive budgets, sometimes an order of magnitude greater, because they used analytics and because they applied metrics to a situation where metrics had not been well applied before. If you look at modern baseball teams, the biggest teams in the world have more than 10 PhD statisticians on staff. That's how big of a competitive advantage it is. Consider also the field of insurance. So 50 years ago, if you went to buy a car insurance policy, the only thing they cared about was how old are you, what's the car that you're going to drive, and how old is the car, right? And just based on those pieces of data, they'll look at a chart and say, okay, your premium every month is X dollars or X pounds. And it's interesting when you start to think about that, the people who were very safe drivers thought that they got a terrible deal. Right? And some of them decided not to buy insurance. If it wasn't mandated, they decided not to buy it because they knew that they were very safe drivers. If you contrast that to the way that insurance is done today, they ask an incredible amount of personal questions. I just changed insurance providers about 6 months ago, and they asked me things like, how many children do I have? What's the highest degree of education that I have? How long have I been married? And these aren't random questions. It's not like, do you like KFC or do you like McDonald's? These are things statistically calculated over a large data set to say, you know what, if this person has kids, statistically, they tend to be a safer driver. And they price your premium based on that data and based on that analytics. And the companies that are better at that are the ones that win in the marketplace. My father owns an insurance company in the Bahamas. And it's hurricane insurance, which is a very interesting field. His blood pressure goes up right around this time of year. And it's fascinating to see how that industry worked. So it used to be, if you were in the Bahamas and you owned a home, your insurance premium, the amount you paid for insurance, would be solely based on the value of the property. If this is a $500,000 house, look at a table, and this is what you pay in premiums. But it turned out there were a lot of people that hurricane after hurricane after hurricane never got affected by the hurricane and thus decided to drop their hurricane insurance, which makes sense. It's logical. Only after they invested in technology that measured the elevation of the homes. And in the Bahamas, if you've ever been there, the place is incredibly flat, right? So an elevation difference is this much as opposed to being on some kind of hill. That made a dramatic change to the premium and the risk. So now somebody who would have never bought hurricane insurance before, they now were able to approach them with an offer that was half as much in cost, and they bought it. And it was an incredible differentiator around revenue. So I'd argue the field of baseball and the field of insurance and pricing insurance have moved from opinion and very limited fact to being run like a business. And if you see the amount of analytics that happens today in car insurance, it's incredible. In fact, many places, including here in the Netherlands, you can find car insurance companies that will give you a device that you voluntarily put in your car, and they'll just monitor how you drive, which seems really scary at first until they tell you that we'll give you a 30% reduction on your car insurance cost. And people are like, okay, I'll have somebody drive along with me and see how these things actually go. So metrics have created a massive competitive advantage in that space. The last one is something that I think has affected all of us, is a change in commerce. If you opened a bookstore 20 years ago, you'd have an opinion on which books you bought and how you would place those books. And it wouldn't be based on data. It would be based on a feeling or anecdotes of people in the neighborhood and what kinds of stuff that they bought in the past. Now, whenever you buy something online, there's an incredible amount of analytics that goes just into the presentation of offers to you. So this is my Amazon landing page, which is very different from my wife's. If you looked at this thing, I'd say 2 years ago, it would be all books on assembly code and x86 instruction sets and that type of thing. Recently, I wrote a business book, so now it's all business-related things. And apparently, I bought shoes. I guess that's why. That's why that's there. But this looks very different than my wife's, and it looks very different than probably anybody else in this room. And it's because they know a lot about me, and they're able to present offers, and it increases their revenue. And I can promise you, the companies that are doing this more efficiently are winning in the marketplace. Now, think about the current state of information security. I would argue in this transition of pre-analytics to post-analytics, we are still in the pre-analytics phase. If you look at the headlines, much security spending today is very reactionary. We have a huge set of activity around hacktivism, distributed denial of service attacks, then followed by a massive investment in distributed denial of service prevention. We have a huge uptick in targeted attacks, advanced persistent, whatever you want to call them. And there's a massive uptick in the types of technologies that look for systems that have been infiltrated. This is how this industry has gone for a very long time. But the problem, the question that we could never answer is a year after we bought that stuff, whatever it is, how much value did it actually bring to the business? Not how much safer are we? I think that's even a different question. How much value did it bring to the business? If you think about the change in velocity of IT, the way that users are now dictating what IT is, we have to figure out what our degrees of freedom are. So if you talk to many folks that have been in security for a long time, and you talk to them about things like Dropbox or things like Google Docs, they immediately panic and say, look, we can't have our most sensitive information in the world hanging out in some service that's in a public cloud. Now, you think about that, and you have to ask two questions. One, is it happening anyway? Right? Very important question. Almost always the answer is yes. The second question is, how much of that use actually matters to the safety of the business? That's a very scary question, I think, for us to ask. The other thing that we have to deal with is a bunch of what I'd call still legacy security problems that are either unsolved or we've made a certain set of investments to try and make them better. So this is a word cloud that was built based on the submissions that came in to RSA Europe 2013. So these are people that submitted talks that would hopefully get accepted, and the program committee narrowed it down to the talks that you see here as part of the agenda. But there's something interesting to learn when you start to look at these word clouds. One of the most fascinating things to me is how much these change year over year. I don't think you'd be surprised by the big words that pop out on this thing. Things like cloud, mobile, which is huge, data. You see analytics in the mix. So we have to figure out, among this massive set of possible things that we can invest in or make go-forward investments in, which ones actually matter to the business and what our degrees of freedom are that we can ignore. So this question about assessing risk has always been the bane of security, and I would argue that the problem is we have not accepted that additional investment in some security technology eventually creates diminishing returns. Now, many of you have seen curves that look like this before. In statistics, we'd call it an S curve. Here, I call it a plateau curve. But it's interesting to think about where your technology investments are in that stack, even where your investments are in things like training. It's very easy to believe that you are on the far left side of this graph, meaning if you invest an additional dollar in whatever it is, if it's a training campaign, an awareness campaign, that you are going to get a ratcheted set of enterprise improvement. But the truth is, I think many of the technologies that we have, some of them we're already on the far right. So if we make additional investments, we do have an improvement, but that improvement is in very small and incremental. This happens in every discipline of life, right? How much does the third trip to the gym this week matter versus the fourth trip? I'd argue the third trip is more important than the fourth trip in terms of benefit to you, long-term health, weight loss, that type of thing. And this plateau curve dictates many aspects of our lives, and if you look at almost every industry follows this. But I would argue our biggest challenge is we don't know where specific technologies sit along the plateau curve. Now, last year, I introduced this image as a potential exit path for data analytics. And I'll go over it just a second to recap. But I think that there's something interesting that I've learned about it since that time. So if you watch, and a lot of this conference is talking about the lessons learned from the Olympics. I really enjoyed Mark Hughes's presentation earlier. But if you watch the Olympics, one of the most interesting sports is the uneven bars. And if you watch the uneven bars, you're fixated on the gymnast, on the incredible things that the gymnast can do. But most people ignore the spotter that stands beneath the gymnast. And a spotter has a very important role to play. He's dynamic in the way that he protects her. He assesses the situation. He looks at a long history of data and how she's performed and when she's in a dangerous part of her routine. And he adapts and he protects. And he's open to failure, but he tries to minimize and reduce failure. So he's very dynamic. Security, I think, is becoming much more like the spotter in many ways, but one way that I think is particularly interesting is that the spotter does not tell the gymnast what she can or cannot do. And that's one of the biggest transitions that we're going through right now in security. In the past, we have had veto power in the business. If security came back and said, no, this thing that you're planning to do, this thing is way too risky. There's no way we're going to do it. How many of us have sat in a room 5 years ago, so this is going back to 2008, and somebody in the business comes up with some huge cloud initiative. Wow, this is going to be amazing. Look at how much money this is going to save the company. And from a security perspective, you come back and say, look, we just don't know enough about this. We can't do it. And the business would listen to you. But then we had an economic downturn, and operational efficiency trumped security. So people went out and just did it. And the role of security was, hey, try and manage it. Try and reduce the risk on this decision that was already made. I think that that was a very interesting precursor to some of the stuff we're experiencing right now. 5 years ago, you'd see some people take a very hard line on BYOD. We're not going to allow it. It can't happen. It's too dangerous. We can't have our stuff on this guy's device. Have you seen this guy? You know, there'd be all those types of arguments. Today, I think most of us have accepted that we can't stop that transition. Users have better technology at home and a better experience at home than they have at work. They're ashamed to take the BlackBerry out and put it on the table, where 5 years ago, if you were on a date, that's the first thing you did, is put the BlackBerry on the table to impress the person on the other side. Right? Now you're sort of ashamed of having it. And it's interesting because people are now dictating the structure of IT. In that kind of environment, it's more critical than ever for us to figure out which things that we have to take a hard line on and which things we just think are risky but really don't know. And I think that's where big data can take us. When you see sessions over this week on analytics, I think an important litmus test on those sessions is not just about threats and anticipating an attacker and figuring out if somebody's already inside, but asking the question, does this type of analytics actually allow me to make a better decision on the infrastructure that I already have? Does it help me make a better choice? So I mentioned that the spotter cannot tell the gymnast what to do or what not to do. He can't tell the gymnast, you shouldn't do this third flip. It's really dangerous. Instead, it's up to her. She does the third flip, and his job is to be there and respond and protect her. And I think that's the role that security is transitioning to in the business as we learn more about ourselves. It's much more aligned with the business. It's asking the question, where does the business want to go? How do we help the business grow? And how can we be there to protect? So moving from this ministry of no, and we can always figure out a reason why this thing is too risky to do, to being much more agile, much more business aligned, in spite of the fact that we're at the most threatening time, I would argue, in the history of security. Those two things don't tend to go together, but I think that that's the exact transition that security's going through now. And if you think about where we'll be 5 years from now, and this is very much a go-forward investment statement, I think in all of us personally, I think the discipline of security will be much more a business discipline than it is a technology discipline. I think it'll be the CISOs, the security directors, that are very aligned with the direction of the business, who can figure out quickly that these things really don't matter. They seem risky, but they really don't matter. They're degrees of freedom and become very flexible. So I'll leave you with a last story. And this one has had a massive impact on my career personally. And this happened to me, I guess 10 years ago on a plane. And for those of you that have seen me talk before, you know that statistically I spend a lot of time on planes, and very strange things tend to happen to me on planes. Birds and other animals tend to appear. But I was on a plane about 10 years ago, and I sat next to a guy, and instantly we got into a very heated argument. I can't remember how it started, but it was over Star Trek Deep Space Nine. I don't know how many people here are Star Trek fans. I would imagine this crowd, there's a pretty big crossover. I personally think that Deep Space Nine is a blemish on the Star Trek brand, and I feel very passionately about it. And this guy was a massive Deep Space Nine fan. He could, recount specific episodes and quotes from Quark. I mean, it's just terrible. So knowing that we were going to sit next to each other for the rest of the flight, we agreed to disagree. And so trying to change the topic, I asked him, what do you do? What kind of business are you in? And he said, I'm in IT. And I said, I'm not surprised. And so then he told me about a company, a manufacturing company that he started at just a couple of years before that. So maybe 15 years ago now. And he started this company, system administrator, and he sees this one critical system that runs a bunch of the manufacturing equipment on the floor, doesn't have any backup and recovery disk, mortal sin of any IT system. And so he goes in, he makes a set of these disks, and they're 5 1/4 inch floppies. I don't know if anybody remembers those things. Nostalgic. I should have a picture of it. 5 1/4 inch floppies. He makes a set of these. It takes 10 of them to create a full set. He walks over to the secretary's office and says, can you please label these disks and put them in a fireproof safe? Right? And she says, yes, I'll do it right away. 6 months later, something terrible happens. Massive power spike. The system is completely fried. He has to take a secondary system and bring it online. So he goes to the admin's office and says, can I please have those disks? She gives him the disks, puts the first one in the disk slot, closes that little thing that comes over the disk. I don't know if anybody remembers that. And he sees the two scariest words that you could ever see as a system administrator: media error. Next one, same thing, media error. Third one, media error. The entire stack is corrupt. So then he spends 3 days, no sleep, building the system again from scratch. He goes back after this, this kind of 3-day marathon, goes to her office with a new set of backup recovery disks and says, look, can you please take these disks and put them in the fireproof safe? She sees he's very upset, and she's like, I'll do it right now. He walks over to her coffee machine, takes a cup of coffee, contemplating a career change. I think we've all been there. And she takes the first disk. She puts it on the table. She takes a label out of the drawer, sticks it on the desk. Then she takes the disk and she shoves it into the typewriter. Crank, crank, crank. And she starts typing on it, B for backup. Whack, the type head hits it, A or something. And obviously completely destroying the desk. And he realizes that every disk he's ever given her is gone, right? Completely destroyed. Now, what's interesting about this that he said is that the follow-on question was this her fault? Was this her fault that she had been systematically destroying these disks? And it turns out the conclusion was that it wasn't. So she had a repeatable process. Whenever it was an algorithm, whenever somebody gave her something to label, her algorithm was, if thin enough to fit in typewriter, put it in a typewriter. Right? It's worked before, repeatable process, CMM level 5, very well documented, everything's good. But now they had given her a new piece of technology, but not the knowledge on how to use it safely. And I would argue that that's exactly what we have done today in the IT space. People are on LinkedIn, they're on Twitter, they're on social networking sites, and we still don't have an idea. Each individual employee does not have an idea of what their degrees of freedom are. that it's okay to talk about your cat and everything that happened this week and put a picture of them in some kind of spacesuit or whatever you need to do with the cat. But it's not okay to talk about an IT support issue in the business on your personal Twitter feed. Right? They don't have a sense yet of the degrees of freedom. And I would argue that in security, our biggest challenge going forward is to help the business calibrate on what these degrees of freedom are. And I think it's an incredibly exciting time because I think what we're going to find out at the end of it is there's only a small subset of the things that we are worried about today that matter the most. And I think that we are going to be in a profession of enablement, that security will be measured by what we make possible, not what we prevent. So thank you very much. I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference, and please avoid the coffee shops. Thanks so much.